check this out. This is really cool. See this photo? Now watch this. And boom! Pretty cool, huh? Now, can we use this capability to take better virtual tour photos? Absolutely. And I'll show you in a little bit. Now, the camera that I used for that shot was the Theta Z1. If you're just catching up, the Theta Z1 is the first consumer 360 camera to have a 1-inch sensor. That's huge. That's more than 4 times larger than the standard 1 over 2.3-inch sensor. Now, last week, I told you that I'd show you an amazing new feature that I've never seen in any other 360 camera. And that was not it. So stick around, I have something even better to show you guys. By the way, if you're new to this channel, my name is Mick, and I've been a photographer since 2007. And I've been shooting 360 cameras since May of 2015. And I have over 60 360 cameras, and I've written over 2,500 articles on 360 cameras and VR. So if you want to learn more about 360 cameras and how to use them, go ahead and hit subscribe and don't forget to hit the notification bell. Now, you're watching part 2 of my in-depth review on the Theta Z1. In part 1, I showed you some features for image quality and workflow. I also showed you how the Theta Z1 compares in detail to other popular 360 cameras. Now, if you haven't seen that video, go check it out. Now, in this video, I'm gonna show you other aspects of the Theta Z1's image quality. First, I'm gonna show you its stitching quality, and in particular, its minimum stitching distance. Then, I'm gonna show you its low light performance. Then, we'll talk about dynamic range, and you already saw some of its shadow recovery capabilities. But I have something even better to show you guys. And finally, we'll conclude with, should you buy the Theta Z1? Now, by the way, just a reminder, this is based on the pre-release version of the Theta Z1, and I expect there will be continuous improvements to it. So if you want to learn all the updates to the Theta Z1, check out this link below. First, let's talk about stitching. The Theta Z1 is just like other Thetas, so that when it takes photos, it stitches them in camera with optical flow stitching for extra smooth stitching. Now, we gotta remember the Theta Z1 does have a larger sensor. So one difference between the Theta Z1 and the previous Thetas is that there's a larger distance between the lenses. And so there's greater parallax stitching error. This raises the question, what's the minimum stitching distance for the Theta Z1? So to test that, I took photos of myself at the stitch line at various distances, starting from 10 feet all the way to 1 foot. And here are the results. Now, as you can see, the stitching is really good. And one thing I like about the Theta Z1 compared to previous Thetas is that it's much sharper toward the stitch line. It's sharp almost all the way until the very stitch line itself. But when we get to around 3 feet, then the stitching starts looking a little iffy. And at 2 feet, it doesn't look good at all. So is that it? Are we stuck at 3 feet? Not quite, because the Theta Z1 has one more trick up its sleeve. See, unlike other Thetas, the Z1 can take photos in unstitched RAW DNG format. And when you do that, you can adjust the stitching. Check this out. So let's say I wanted to adjust the stitching of this photo. Now, I happen to take this photo in both RAW and JPEG. So let's take a look at the RAW version. After editing the photo, I can right click on it, go to Ricoh Stitcher, and in Ricoh Stitcher, I can change the stitching distance. And bam, stitching fixed. So with this capability, how close is the minimum stitching distance of the Theta Z1? Well, I found out it's as close as 1 foot. And that's really cool because it lets us take photos in tight spaces. By the way, if you don't have Lightroom, you can also stitch the Z1 photos in PTGUI. There's a stitching template made just for it. Now let's talk about the Z1's low light performance. To test the Z1's low light capability, I took photos both outdoors and indoors. And I also took low light photos at various ISOs, starting from the base ISO all the way to ISO 6400. Now, of course, we see a lot of noise, but you know one thing I like about the Z1 is the colors. Normally with high ISOs, we see colors getting faded and it starts losing contrast. But with the Z1, the colors remain saturated and reasonably accurate all the way up to 6400 ISO. Now let's talk about the Theta Z1's dynamic range and its ability to capture both highlight details and shadow details. So I used the same photos that we used for the resolution test and I looked at the highlight and shadow detail. Now the Theta Z1's dynamic range looks really good in these photos, but so do other 360 cameras. Does that mean that the Theta Z1's dynamic range is just the same as other 360 cameras? Not quite. To see the full potential of the Z1's dynamic range, let's push the exposure a little bit in post-processing. Now let's say we wanted to take a photo of a scene with a very high dynamic range, really bright highlights and really deep shadows. Now we can take HDR photos, but sometimes there's a moving subject. Like in this scene, for example, I was shooting a photo at an arcade, and obviously with like lots of moving animations and stuff, you couldn't use HDR. For this kind of scene, when we're using a digital sensor, we know that the best technique is to expose for the highlights. So the question is, if we expose for the highlights, how well can the Theta Z1 recover the shadows? And the Z1 does a fantastic job of recovering shadows. In this scene, I had actually underexposed it by 5 stops. Now when I normalized the exposure of this shot in Lightroom, I was really surprised because there was very little noise and it was able to recover the colors and contrast accurately. This lets me capture a really wide dynamic range without HDR. When you push the exposure for the Theta Z1 by more than 3 stops, there's a significant amount of chroma noise. Now the good news is that Lightroom's chroma noise reduction works pretty well, but it doesn't get rid of all the chroma noise. But there's a trick for getting rid of that. Watch this. The technique that I use doesn't use any third-party plugins or software, and it's really easy to use. Now if you want to learn how to do that, I've got good news for you, because I'm actually creating a free video tutorial that will show you exactly how to do that. So to see that video, you gotta do 2 things. First, leave a comment below with the hashtag 360 cameras. Then send an email to this address with the subject line Theta Z1 tutorial. When my video is done, I'll send you a link to that private YouTube video where you can learn how to do this technique. But if you're gonna push the exposure in post, that's gotta incur a noise penalty, right? That leads me to the next topic, which is the feature that I wanted to tell you guys about, and it's ISO invariance. What's that? Imagine you have a scene with really wide dynamic range. Now what if you could use different ISOs for different parts of the scene? For the really bright highlights, let's use a really low ISO, the base ISO. And for the deep shadows, let's use a higher ISO. Is that possible? With ISO invariance, yes. Here, let me show you. So to test the ISO invariance, I took 2 sets of photos. So in one set of photos, I took it at base ISO with intentional underexposure of, let's say, 2 stops, and then I pushed the exposure 2 stops in post-processing. Then I compared that to another set of photos where I had shot it at 2 stops above base ISO. Now normally, when you push the exposure in post-processing, there is a noise penalty. But not so with the Z1. Check this out. Here is a photo that was pushed 1 stop. And here's a photo that was shot at 1 stop above base ISO. No difference. Let's try it at 2 stops. I can't see a difference. 3 stops. 4 stops. Even 5 stops. This is amazing, and I've never seen this capability in any other consumer or professional 360 camera.
To summarize, instead of shooting at the normal exposure, we expose for the highlights. With ISO invariance, it will be as if the brightest highlights are shot at the base ISO, while the darker parts of the image are shot at proportionately higher ISOs to bring out shadow detail and get a much wider dynamic range.
You may have seen a video by Tony Northrup where he claims that all cameras are ISO-less. In other words, all cameras are ISO invariant. And that's a load of BS. The truth is that some cameras are ISO invariant, but others are not. If you don't believe me, you can check out these tests by DP Review. They've been testing ISO invariance since like 2015 or something. And you can see that not all cameras perform the same. And as I'll show you, there are limits to ISO invariance even for the Theta Z1. It depends on the lighting conditions. In bright light, the Theta Z1 is indeed ISO invariant. But with less light, the Theta Z1 is not ISO invariant. Here, let me show you. So we took this same scene, but this time, let's look at a different part of the scene, a shaded part of the scene, so there's less light. Here's a comparison at one stop above base ISO, two stops, three stops, four stops, and five stops. So as you can see, when there isn't a lot of light, the Theta Z1 is not ISO invariant. Now let's talk about the Theta Z1's weaknesses. There are five main weaknesses. Number one is the battery. It's not removable and it drains pretty fast. Now you can charge it via USB while using it, but it's a little bit extra inconvenience. Second is the memory. It's also not removable and it's limited to 19 gigs. And that's, I guess you could say that's plenty for photos. But if you take bracketed photos in RAW plus JPEG, then that can go pretty fast. And if you take videos, then that's not a lot either. And speaking of video, that's weakness number three. The video is just too low res in 2019. It's 4K, and unfortunately, 2019, 4K is just not good enough. It looks a little too contrasty. You can see a big difference between the detail of the cameras such as the One X or Fusion or Rilo or views compared to the Theta Z1. Weakness number four is ruggedness or lack thereof. The Theta Z1 doesn't have a special case to protect it from elements, so you can't really use it for action, nor can you use it underwater. Now, if you want to use it for underwater, there is one case that you could use, which is the Theta 360 bubble. I don't have one, but if you have one, it will probably work with the Theta Z1. Number five is connectivity. I can connect to the Theta Z1 most of the time, but around like 10-20% of the time, the Theta Z1 will connect to my phone, but the app cannot find the Z1. And it's kind of frustrating when that happens. Usually what I do is I reboot my Theta Z1 and sometimes it helps it connect, but sometimes I just can't connect either. So there's that one thing to consider. All right, let's wrap up. Is the Theta Z1 the ultimate 360 camera for virtual tours? And should you buy it? Well, compared to consumer 360 cameras such as the Insta360 One X, GoPro Fusion, or Xiaomi Mi Sphere or Ricoh Theta V, the Theta Z1 clearly has better image quality. It has significantly better detail, better dynamic range, you saw the amazing shadow recovery, and ISO invariance. What about professional 360 cameras like the Panono or the Aleta S2C? Now, first of all, the Panono and the Aleta S2C do have more detail than the Theta Z1, but the Theta Z1 arguably has better shadow recovery and dynamic range. The Aleta S2C does have bracketing mode to increase the dynamic range, but so does the Theta Z1. Neither the Panono nor the Aleta S2C can take photos in RAW format. Because they take photos only in JPEG, it limits the ability to edit their photos for not just for color temperature, but we're also talking about shadow recovery. Now with the Theta Z1, not only can you take photos in RAW plus JPEG, but you can also edit the unstitched RAW photos before stitching them in Lightroom. And you can also adjust the stitching distance. This gives you unparalleled flexibility to edit your photos. So in my view, if you edit your photos, then the Theta Z1 is going to be a better 360 camera than the Panono or Aleta S2C. Is it worth spending the extra over its competitors such as the Insta360 One X or GoPro Fusion? And I think the answer is a qualified yes for two groups of people primarily. First are virtual tour photographers who want to take a lot of virtual tour photos and want to spend as little time editing as possible. For those people, the Theta Z1's HDR mode looks great straight out of the camera, even with little or no editing. Second, if you spend a lot of time editing your photos, then the Theta Z1's unparalleled photo editing capabilities are going to open new possibilities for your photography. So if you consider all factors, not just image quality, but also workflow, then in my opinion, the Theta Z1 is indeed the ultimate 360 camera for virtual tours as of April 2019. So, I have a couple requests from 360 Rumors readers and viewers. So, Manel wanted to see a sample photo from the Theta Z1 in a small space and with a window. So, Manel, thanks for your request. Check this out. Another request is from Jocelyn. He wanted to see a sample of the spatial audio. So, I have a sample here. It's an unlisted video. Go check out the link. Thanks, and I'll see you in 360.